where you could be found. Told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy. The boys are back in town, the boys are back in town. I said, the boys are back in town, the boys are back in town.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Fishin, the podcast where we discuss Legacy's most competitive tribe and help the whole community become better Merfolk players. I'm Kody, one of the co-hosts of this show, and not Kody Smith on Twitter. And we also have, as always, Matt. How are you doing, Matt?
Well, not as always. So there was some marital disputes between Kody and I the last couple weeks. I did leave the show. I threw up two fingers and said sayonara. But after hearing the nightmare that was monkeying around, I knew that Kody needed me. So I'm back.
Yeah, I mean, our tenuous relationship will continue, and hopefully we can work out further problems without having to call in legal help. But we will get through this somehow, I'm sure. And we will continue making Merfolk content until something really drives a wedge between us.
We're going to be like flipper-flop California. We're going to still be divorced. We're going to see other people, but we're going to continue to work together.
Well, I mean, yeah, the show has to go on. That's kind of important. That's imperative, really, for both of our sakes.
I think so.
This is our only shot at fame.
For you, maybe.
Oh, well, yeah, that's fair. You have a degree at least, so. We would like to thank you for sharing our podcast and rating us. We actually got we're up to a couple 5-star reviews. We even got a new review on iTunes, so thank you very much for doing that. That helps kind of push us to the top and share it, helps people find us that are looking for us. And again, just telling a friend, that one guy in your shop that only plays Merfolk, tell him about us, because you know he'd probably listen. I think
actually just tell anybody about us, because even though we do predominantly talk Merfolk, we talk a lot of other stuff as well, and our show is just awesome and we're amazing people. So you should support us.
Yep. And
I'm not a arrogant at all.
Definitely. Any support we can get is definitely helpful. And we'd also like to thank our new patron, who is Max. So thank you, Max, for becoming a patron.
Max.
And you can actually find Max. We did a video with Max a little bit ago. I beat him playing on his stream. He played a Walls tribal deck in Modern, and we kind of just swam under and around and through the walls, thanks to Island Walk. But you can find him on Twitch and Twitter as Jungle Fiverr. It's Jungle and then Fiverr, F-I-V-E-R.
So you're going to have to rematch him now that the new Elder Dragon Wall Lord is available.
I think we're going to...
Things might get different.
Yeah, I think that game would have gone very differently if you had a 4-drop that just makes all your walls attack as if they were, you know... 8/8. I think that game goes differently.
Was he playing Dorne in the Siege Tower? Was that kind of how he was doing it, or
no? It was a combo deck with Axebane Guardian and Villainous Wealth. It was.
I mean, I guess Dorne doesn't make your walls be able to attack anyway because they all have defenders. So,
well, it makes them deal damage, assign damage that their toughness would. So. It was just a combo deck that just was like a big mana deck to play Villainous Wealth. But it turns out when you play Villainous Wealth against a Merfolk deck, you have a bad time because the Island Walk is symmetrical. It's all Merfolk.
What is skiing about? Having a good time. That's right. Now, just a few safety things to keep in mind. First of all, look straight ahead when you ski. If you look down, you're going to fall. You're going to have a bad time. Also, be aware of skiers around you. If you run into another skier, your skis are going to cross. Gonna have a bad time.
So where's the part where we have a good time?
Well, I'll just get that. See, we never have these set up ahead of time. I'm gonna delete all this anyway. But yeah. Like, we never have this set up ahead of time. Like, it's like I could have the clip, but here I am.
I had no idea I was gonna say that.
Yeah. Well, see, that's why we don't know what we're gonna say. We have no control over our mouths.
Exactly. Never have.
So Max picked for his random Merfolk, he picked random Merfolk number 45. And actually, we've gone up in our number of Merfolk that we can draw from, thanks to Battle Bond and M19. But so Random Merfolk number 45 is actually a pretty sweet one. Can you read it for us, Matt?
Yeah, no, this one's actually super spicy. It's Fallout Boy?
Is it Fallout Boy on a magic card?
It is Fallout Boy.
It's Fallout Sage, I think.
The number one with the bullet, loaded gun chomp complex, cock it and pull it?
Something like that.
Something along those lines.
It was hotly debated at my junior high. It was...
Anyway, Fallow Sage is three of anything in a blue for a Merfolk wizard, and he is a 2/2. He has the ability, whenever Fallow Sage becomes tapped, you may draw a card. So this seems like an EDH all-star to me in a Merfolk-based deck, and maybe not even a Merfolk-based deck, maybe even just a blue kind of combo-y deck.
Yeah, and so this kind of works really well with Kumena, because you can just, you know, force tap it to do things. Cryptolith Rite is another one that kind of works well with this card, so you can tap it to add a mana and draw a card, which is pretty bonkers. I'm sure there's, you know, like a card we might talk about later, Earthcraft, you know, if you're if you're able to get, you know, get things going with Earthcraft and do some weird tap shenanigans, you know, drawing a bunch of cards is just a great it's a great value. And I mean, Fallow Sage at 4 mana probably isn't going to do anything in like Modern or Legacy, but definitely a Commander all-star for sure.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So yeah, he's great. There's so many ways you can force him to be tapped. Different enchantments where you can have an ability go off and draw a card at the same time, and then we talked about it before, the one where it's one blue and you untap him.
Freed from the Reel.
Yes, there you go. I mean, so you can kind of combo off and almost even draw your entire library if you can get the infinite mana for it. If you're playing your High Tide Thanos Candelabra deck, for all those for all those EDH players that like playing the $1,000 Antiquities Artifact.
Yeah, sure. That's totally fair.
Hey, if you're not go big or go home. Go big or go home.
Yeah, so I mean, this is just a great card. Thank you again, Jungle Fiverr, aka Max, for another UK MTG content creator, for those hashtag UK MTG UK people. Thank you very much for your support. We definitely appreciate it. So now, Matt, we are going to discuss a format that's very close to both of our hearts. We are going to discuss Merfolk post-legacy bans.
Correct. So we're a little behind the power curve. I know everybody else has already done their legacy bans. What does Deathrite Shaman and Probe being out of the format mean? But we wanted to give it a little bit of time. We didn't want to get caught up in the whole mess of it. And we also wanted to kind of let the dust settle a little bit and kind of think about it. So again, Deathrite Shaman's gone. Probe is gone. These were two very degenerate cards. Both were banned out of Modern. For doing the exact same thing. They just take over games, and they make decks that are already very powerful even more powerful. So, I mean, Phyrexian mana is just the most broken thing. I mean, yeah. It's Storm and Phyrexian mana as like A and B for most broken things ever, abilities ever printed.
Yeah, so basically what I was going to lead to was the main thing with both of these cards is they cheated mana. You know, obviously Phyrexian mana is just straight
cheating. In different
cheating.
Ways.
Yeah, they cheated in different ways. So, I mean, number one, so Gitaxian Probe, you know, you pay basically 2 life, which in Legacy is nothing.
Correct.
I mean, we can admit that 2 life in Legacy is nothing.
Even in Modern, life is nothing.
Yeah, 2 life is two. I mean, starting at 18 life would not be the worst thing to happen in Modern.
Now a Commander, 38, that's just, we're pushing it. You need every point of life a Commander.
They should, you know, we should hashtag ban Gitaxian Probe and Commander.
We really should.
Just ban it in every format. Just have a card that's banned in every format, and it'll be in the history books. But anyway, so like, you know,
Shahrazad, RIP.
Yeah. So we're gonna get into the specifics of the two cards. I mean, we can get into Gitaxian Probe first if you'd like.
Yeah, let's do it. It made games so unfun because turn one, they have perfect information of what you're doing, and they actually get to replace the card that they just played because the card draw ability. So, I mean, you start out with two less life. There's almost no downside. And then on top of that, the Cabal Therapy decks that would probe, get perfect information, play your Underground Sea or whatever, Cabal Therapy, name a card. If you had multiples, that'd be done. You'd lose two. And then next turn, they would play something, sack it, Cabal Therapy for the other card that they know you have in your hand. And by like turn two, you're already down three cards and they have perfect information and they're just running on straight gas.
Well, and so it basically allowed blue decks, like unfair blue decks in Legacy, to basically play a 56 card deck.
Correct.
And one of the biggest thing was, with tutors in Legacy and just raw powerful draw spells like Brainstorm and Ponder, mm-hmm. you had perfect information, so you could see, does my opponent have Force of Will? Does my opponent have, a reanimate? Does my opponent have whatever? And basically, you can dig through your deck and you could, grab answers specifically for whatever your opponent has.
Or just keep shuffling until you find it.
Well, yeah, that's what I mean, is like just like those cards like help you dig. So, mm-hmm. and on top of that, it just replaced itself. You drew another card. So you got perfect information and drew a card for zero mana, mm-hmm. which is dumb. That's terrible. I mean, it definitely helps combo decks to be very, very much, again, Storm, to be very much more streamlined, because once you know where your opponent's at, then you can make better decisions.
Correct. The key to playing a combo decks are easy. Let me rephrase my statement. Comboing off in a combo deck is incredibly easy, because you Google how the combo works, you assemble the necessary cards, and you go. Where the combo deck is incredibly difficult to play is choosing when to combo off, making sure that the opponent does not have the necessary disruption to make you lose the game. Because usually if you combo off and you get disrupted, you've just lost.
Yes.
So Gitaxian Probe, especially in a deck like Storm, was perfect because A, you got perfect information to see if you were safe to start comboing off, or at least attempting to it. And it's added to your Storm count for free. So you didn't have to worry about spending any of your mana that you're creating with your LEDs or your rituals.
Lotus Petals, that sort of thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And so basically what this means for Merfolk is, I mean, some people play Days, most people, everybody plays Force of Will, but basically it allows your opponent to play around the little, interaction that you have with Force of Will and Days, and it helps them search for answers that kind of blanket, nullify your deck. So in Merfolk, we have our Lords that are super important, which again, as Matt said, you could just get rid of with Cabal Therapy, and it's very easy to hit multiples of those. And TNN is just an absolute house to get rid of. If you're able to pull TNNs from your opponent's hand, and then guess what? Post board, you can get in your surgical extractions and just kind of rip your opponent's deck mm-hmm. apart. Like there's nothing stopping you from doing that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And so decks like Merfolk that play lots of similar pieces, redundant pieces rather, I guess is kind of the more correct terminology for it. It really hurts us. And it definitely sets up combo decks to be super consistent against our game plan.
Sure. And the main thing was the Phyrexian mana. Because if you look at a very similar card, it's Peak, which does the exact same thing, except for instead of Phyrexian mana, it costs one blue. That card is nearly unplayable.
Oh, yeah, it's too slow. I mean, just even the one blue, it puts them off a whole turn.
Correct.
I would lose life to Peak any day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's not just being able to draw the card. It's not just being able to see their hand. It's the fact that you get to do that, and on turn one, you still get to play your Delver.
Yep. Yeah, and that's dumb because, then next, on your upkeep, you can Brainstorm to set up, or Ponder rather, to set up a flip Delver, and then you can just start hitting for three every turn. And with protection, basically, with Force of Will, with Days, mm-hmm. you name
it. And knowing what you need to save your Force of Will for.
Yes, that's definitely another thing, is like I said, Merfolk is among the most fair decks in Legacy. Like, it plays its cards, and of course it has Force of Will, but it doesn't run a lot of, you know, dumb counter spells. It does, besides Force of Will, and it does
the dumbest of counter spells.
Yeah, the dumbest counter spell. But I mean, any blue deck worth its salt runs Force of Will and Legacy. But you know, it's not trying to cheat mana. It's not trying to, well, besides Aether Vial, I guess. Geez, I'm making Merfolk sound really unfair.
that's it. This is not a fair deck.
Well, it's more fair than a lot of decks, like Reanimator, Elves, that kind of just do broken things when they get to 2 to 3 mana. And so I guess Merfolk is one of the most fair decks in Legacy, and Probe really kills, you know, not letting us resolve our threats. Again, your opponent can just tutor for whatever they need to counter whatever threat you're trying to resolve. And then once that happens, you know, it's easy for Merfolk to run out of cards. There's not as much card draw in Merfolk.
Yeah, so part of the reason Magic is such a successful game is the ambiguity that comes from not knowing what's in your opponent's hand. So, and now obviously with cards like Thoughtseize and Duress and even Peak. Inquisition of Kozilek, whatever discard or whatever look at your opponent's hand cards there is. You lose that the ambiguity that comes from being a concealed card game, but there's also a lot of drawback that comes with those cards. Whereas Probe, there was barely anything. Two life is nothing.
You forgot about Telepathy.
I'm sorry, Telepathy. Legacy All-Star
Telepathy.
Telepathy, tiny leaders all-star.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know what Telepathy is, it's an enchantment for a blue, I believe, and it makes your opponents play with their hands revealed.
I literally had to Google it.
I played it in a Gwafa Hazid EDH deck that I had for some time, yeah. And that basically was just like pit my opponents against each other. That's kind of a common theme for me in EDH for some reason. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so
go dot deck.
I called it Let's Make a Deal because it was Gwafa Hazid, and yeah. So it basically allowed my opponents, like, you could tap Gwafa to make it so that they just couldn't attack me. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, hey, you've got a giant 12-12 for some reason. Draw a card and it can't attack me.
Yeah.
that seems like an okay proposition. Attack one of those two knuckleheads over there.
Deal or no deal.
Yeah. And but anyway, so I mean I think we've kind of exhausted the Gitaxian Probe discussion there. That's basically it, right? I mean,
yeah.
It helps fair decks. It kind of burns combo decks a little bit. I think the bigger one that we're going to hit is Deathrite Shaman.
Correct. The most powerful planeswalker ever printed.
Yes, for sure.
So Deathrite Shaman, for the one person who is listening to this podcast because they think it's an actual bass fishing podcast, and they haven't realized that it's a fantasy-based card game yet, I will explain this to you.
If you've got 26 episodes deep and you don't know that we're a fantasy-themed collectible card game podcast, then you have other problems. You need to.
When are they going to tell me how to catch Northern Atlantic swordfish?
Well, I'm going to miss her. Well, looky there. I got a bite. it's a master of waves.
I kind of want Kody to record an album now, a country fishing album.
But there's enough songs. I could probably do it.
Kody becomes the old man of the sea.
Yeah, God. No, I'd rather be the sea hunter.
The sea hunter?
Yeah.
So anyway, Deathrite Shaman is one mana. It's a hybrid green-black. So it doesn't matter what you draw. You can play him. And he's a 1/2. Tap him to exile target land from a graveyard. Add one mana of any color. Tap black in him. Exile target instant or sorcery card from a graveyard. Each opponent loses 2 life. Or tap green, or green and tap him. Exile target creature from a graveyard. You gain 2 life. So the main one was that really, I mean, all these abilities put him over the top. But the fact that there's fetch lands are so predominant in this format, and you can play him on turn one. So turn one, you play Pluto Delta, crack, grab your
any fetch land that touches green or blue, or sorry, green or black.
It doesn't even matter. Oh yeah, because you need to play him. Sorry, but yeah, then you grab your underground sea, your bayou, whatever. Then you play Deathrite Shaman, and the next turn you exile the fetch out of your graveyard. You have perfect mana, and you can start playing whatever you want.
Yeah. So
and on top of that, he doesn't just mana fix; he becomes a clock because you're also playing certain spells in those kind of base decks. So he's dealing 2 damage, and if for any reason that you're starting to lose too much life to like an aggro base deck, all of a sudden now you're gaining life.
Yeah, so I want to first touch on the mana production side. So as you said, the thing is in Legacy right now, well, I mean, I guess ever since Legacy has existed, you've had access to every single fetch and every single Alpha Beta Revised Unlimited Duel.
Correct.
And so basically, all you need are fetch lands that touch black or blue, and then dual lands that touch black or blue, which is basically 8 of them.
Correct.
And of both the fetch and the duels.
Or plateau.
Yeah, plateau and scrubland. Scrubland does it too. Yeah.
Come on, do it. We're not moving on
to you. Savannah. No, Savannah does it too. What's the red blue one? Tropical Island. No, Volcanic Island.
There
Volcanic
you go.
Island doesn't do it. I'm as good at Legacy as I am at Photoshop.
You figured it out.
Yeah.
You figured it out. We worked together and figured it out.
All right.
little dinosaur train for all those with toddlers.
Good. But yeah, anyway, so dinosaur train aside, it's one of those things that, you know, that one of the biggest things I wanted to touch on was it basically allowed people to play 3 to 4, even 5 color pile decks and with almost zero consequences. Because one of the drawbacks to playing a 3 to 4 to 5 color deck is, you know, you have restrictions. You have to play dual lands. You have to play, you know, mana fixers like Birds of Paradise or Noble Hierarch to kind of help with your mana fixing. But guess what? With Deathrite Shaman, as Matt said, you play your fetch, you crack your fetch for any duel that touches green or black, and then once you know, on turn 2, you play a second fetch, it doesn't matter, you crack it for any land, and you have basically 3 mana of any color.
And one thing that we need to make abundantly clear is you can hit anybody's graveyard. It's not just yours, but yours and your opponent's.
And many,
so their fetches as well.
Yeah, their fetches, their thought seizes, their whatever's out of their deck. And so, you know, when you're able to play 3 and 4 color decks, you can basically do almost anything. I mean, there's lots of 4 color decks. I mean, there were, I guess, lots of 4 color decks in Legacy. I don't know how well.
So what was occurring was Deathrite Shaman was so powerful that he was getting jammed into almost every deck. Even Turbo Depths, which is one of the decks I prefer, was starting to run 3 Deathrite Shamans because he was just so powerful. One of the great equalizers in Legacy that's been there since almost the beginning has been Wasteland. The idea is you do have all the fetches, you do have the duels that don't do damage to you, the original revised alpha duels, but those mean nothing when they could be wastelanded. The issue that was run into with Deathrite Shaman was it didn't care about wasteland because all you did was give 2 lands for Deathrite Shaman to eat to still give you the perfect mana that you wanted.
Yes, and so this led to a lot of combo decks. This led to a lot of Leovold decks that could just also, you know, run white and green now for some reason, and it's, you know, it was kind of stifling, you know, to basically have almost, I mean, maybe burn and Death and Taxes probably don't run, you know, are the only ones that I remember that don't run it. But
you're seeing these people play 4 color decks and having zero problem with any mana.
Yes.
Ever.
And so, that's kind of the main thing. That's the biggest problem with it. But
and Legacy has a ton of broken things. As you said, Brainstorm, Ponder, Him to Turok,
Cabal Therapy,
Swords to Plowshare. So I mean, this allowed decks like Four Color Delver and Grixis Delver to just jam all the most powerful cards ever printed into one deck and be able to play them anytime they wanted. Essentially.
You could almost have a deck that was all one drops, like all one cost spells and Delver Secrets, four of Delver and four of Shaman and just like hammer people.
Chalice of the Void decks would love that.
Oh, I'm sure they would. but anyway, I mean, even just getting past that, as you said, Matt, you know, most decks that played, besides Delver decks, I guess, were mostly controlling or combo decks that played Deathrite Shaman. And one of the things, like you said, with that perfect mana, you know, you often got to a point where you had enough removal spells to stop your opponent's threats. And then you could either start gaining life, if you were down on life, like against Burn or Merfolk or something along those lines, a more aggressive deck. But once you got to a stable life total, you could just kind of start eating away at graveyards and ping them down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, I mean, and even once you get one or two going, you could gain two life and have your opponent lose two life a turn.
Yeah, because essentially at this point in the game, you have the board under control.
Yeah, once it gets to 4, 5, 6...
Yeah.
Turn 4 through 7, like that's kind of where things are kind of turning to one player or the other.
You have your Jace the Mind Sculptor down and your Fate Sealing every turn, and then you're just kind of just chipping away with your Deathrite.
Yep. And so basically it got to a point where, you know, aggressive decks like Merfolk and Burn and even Elves in some matchups, you know, you wouldn't be able to do anything. You would just be stuck losing life and not being able to draw not be able to draw cards. And so it was a very controlling card for sure.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, I mean, what does the Deathrite ban mean for Merfolk really?
For me, I don't think it means much. I really don't. So the format's going to shake up. For example, Grixis Delver, which was an overwhelmingly the most powerful deck in the format since Miracles got hit with the top ban, is going to go down a little bit. I don't think Grixis Delver is necessarily going to go away, but they're not going to be able to play no basic lands anymore.
Yes.
There's going to be some stuff they're going to have to figure out. So that's going to happen. The four color control decks are probably for the most part going to go to the wayside.
And this
is actually just for we're recording this before the Pro Tour. So we don't know what's going to happen. This is all speculation based on our previous knowledge of the format. I'm sure we'll go back and we'll talk about it again after the Pro Tour when the people who actually know what they're doing show up. But yeah, so and Wasteland's going to come back. So I think that more land-based decks like Eternal Garden lands and Turbo Depths are going to take a little bit of a step back because we're going to see more Wasteland because it's more powerful now.
Mm-hmm.
Because when the land hits the graveyard, it's actually going to be gone and not actually produce mana anymore. So, but none of those things really affect Merfolk.
Well, so I actually have some counterpoints to that. I'm not disagreeing with you in any way. I think that all the points you made are valid. But a couple things I wanted to say in the Merfolk matchups are number one, it makes Vile or Aether Vile better. So the way it makes Aether Vile better is because these 3 to 5 color combo decks or control decks that were playing Deathrite Shaman aren't ahead on mana in the same way they were before. What makes Aether Vile good is being ahead of our opponents on, in quotes, mana with Aether Vile. Being able to deploy our threats faster than our opponents are able to either A, answer them, or B, you know, equal them.
Well, you just play Aether Vile on one with your blue mana monkey.
Yeah, with our simian monkey guide, simian merfolk guide, that'll totally be. I think they should really get on that. They should make Atlantis merfolk guide, and just like that would be it. Like
Starkist fish guide.
Yeah, something like that. It'd be totally fair.
Chicken of the sea.
Yeah.
Guide.
My tuna casserole is approved by the U.S. government.
My tuna salad has an okay from Washington.
Chicken of the sea is the only leading tuna that gets voluntary federal inspection for wholesomeness and quality. So it's the only one that earns this government seal.
Who made this delicious tuna?
Secretary of Tuna.
Huh? Ask any mermaid you happen to see. What's the best tuna? Chicken of the sea.
Yeah, we could definitely have a tuna can style merfolk lady be at the front of this. But
exactly.
Anyway, it makes Aether Vial work the way it does in modern, where it actually puts you ahead. You know, being able to deploy threats or uncounterable threats even puts those threats into play and kind of get ahead of your opponent. It also makes Curse Catcher better. Because when your opponent is just able to tap the Deathrite Shaman to pay the extra mana for countering with the Curse Catcher, they're able to kind of get you. You know, like if you're not careful and you crack Curse Catcher to stop a Force of Will or something like that, they may not have any lands open, but they can tap a Deathrite Shaman and stop that Force of Will. Yeah, with a counterspell. And it's one of those things that it really made Curse Catcher not as good as it used to be.
Sure. But Curse Catcher is the worst Curse Catcher.
No, it is, but I mean in Legacy you play it. And I mean, it's one of those things that, you know, it made it worse than it already is.
Well, and most Legacy decks aren't running very many if you're hitting 2, 3, 4 mana, I mean, that's good for a lot of Legacy decks. Because
yes.
they're so finely tuned and everything's such a low to the ground for the mana cost.
Yes. And I mean, even technically both of these decks, what it does is, or with both Deathrite and Probe, is it kills a lot of decks that had one mana removal. So Swords to Plowshares, I mean, I don't know any decks that run Path to Exile in Legacy, but I mean, there's plenty of it.
I think Miracle sometimes runs one in the sideboard.
Okay.
To have a fifth.
Yeah.
Sword Splasher.
And I mean, even just the hand disruption at one mana is incredible. I mean, there's Thoughtseize, there's Inquisition, and all that stuff is run to disrupt slower/fair decks like Merfolk. And so what it does is it puts combo decks like half a step back from where they were when they had the extra mana off of Deathrite.
Yeah.
So I do think this is good for Merfolk. I don't think it's the silver bullet that Merfolk needed to be a tier one, you know, all dominating deck. But
I agree to a certain extent, because there's a reason why he was being jammed into every deck, because he was that good. Now that every deck is removing him, every deck is going to slightly take a step back. Some are going to take much larger steps back than others. Merfolk was one of the very few decks that did not jam him in because there was just nowhere to put him. So you're absolutely right. They are going to be staying stagnant is better than moving backwards. But again, as I said, I don't see this being such a huge thing. I think Probe even making Storm worse, or again, Storm might not even be playable anymore in Legacy. We'll have to see. Might be a better thing for Merfolk.
Well, and like I said, at the beginning, you know, we kind of discussed that Merfolk is kind of unfair. It cheats with Aether Vial and it cheats with Force of Will. But basically, that's the way it cheats. It doesn't cheat in other ways. Like, it doesn't have a mana dork. It doesn't have a fog. It doesn't have hand disruption. So a lot of decks, you know, run hand disruption. They run, like in elves. I mean, I honestly don't think that elves gets hit too bad with Deathrite Shaman banning, but it does hurt it a little bit. And so, you know, it does put it ahead one turn on mana. And sometimes that one turn in Legacy means everything in a game of Magic.
Legacy decks are very finely tuned. If they're losing a card from their deck and having to put something else in there, they're putting something else in there that's not as good as the thing that was being forced to be removed. So, yes. In so facto, the deck becomes slightly worse.
Yep. And so kind of leaning into this, you know, what decks kind of benefit from this ban besides Merfolk kind of benefits marginally, I think. But I mean, there's some, I think a lot of, you know, reanimator decks kind of, or some kind of better combo decks went out in this.
So I disagree with the reanimator. I know the reason why Deathrite took so long to be banned was Wizards argued that Deathrite keeps reanimator and graveyard based strategies under control. I don't think it ever really did that because reanimator is a turn one, turn two combo. I think really what kept or what's going to keep reanimator and dredge and all those decks under control is the same card that has been doing that, and that's Leyline of the Void.
Well, that and like Grafdigger's Cage and Relic of Progenitus, those are all cards that.
You missed the biggest one, Surgical Extraction. And the reason why Surgical and Leyline are going to be the two biggest is because they're free. A lot of those decks are going to be so fast that like Grafdigger's Cage and Relic are going to be slightly too slow to do anything to them.
Well, and I mean, obviously reanimator decks have always kind of hurt on the draw. Because of those one mana cards. And generally, like, you know, as we said, Surgical Extraction, Grafdigger's Cage, those are cards that are pulled out of the sideboard. Those aren't cards that you generally
watch out. Surgical Extraction, you're one of the last standing Phyrexian mana cards. You're next.
Yeah. And I mean, you know, Merfolk honestly might have a main board answer coming with Mistcaller. And I will test it. Because I'm that guy. I'm the person who will test it.
I'll have four foil copies.
I will have four foils. I will test it
in Russian.
They will not be Russian. they will. I think my one playset of foil Russian stuff is enough for me. But anyway, like, you know, we may have a mainboard answer to stop the reanimator menace, and maybe Wizards knew, and that's why Mistcaller got printed. And now we can stop the menace that is Reanimator. It's really not a menace. It's a fine deck. I'm totally fine with it. but anyway, so you have actually a couple other lists here written down.
So the ones that I think actually take a big step forward is Maverick was essentially an unplayable deck with Deathrite because neither Reliquary needs lands in the graveyard, and guess what Deathrite's doing. So I think Maverick is probably back. Do I think it's going to be a top tier deck? Probably not, but I think it's going to be really good. I think it's going to be good.
It's a more budget deck.
It's more budgety. I think I think you're going to see it in a lot more like paper tournaments.
Yeah.
So
budget by Legacy stance, it's like a $1,500 deck. It's not a deck that you're going to spend $500 in and be able to play Maverick and Legacy or anything like that.
Correct. And that's why, like, when you go to paper tournaments, you're going to see like a lot of Death and Taxes. You're going to see a lot of Goblins. And you're probably going to see a lot of Maverick because they're going to be the more affordable decks that people can actually play.
And Burn.
And Burn. I mean, realistically, if Tabernacles weren't like what they're up to, like $3,000 now, you'd be seeing a ton of Eternal Garden because the deck is just fantastic. The reason you don't see a lot of it is because it's super expensive.
I have beaten that deck on stream and I have lost to that deck on stream. It is a very finicky deck, but Tabernacle is a house of a Magic card.
Oh, I love that card and I love that deck. I've wanted to build it for years and I can't remember if I said this on stream or not, but like, I've saved up for Tabernacle a few times in my life, and every time I was super close to buying, it would get one of its big spikes, and then I then I'd get pissed off and buy something else, and then I would start saving up again, and I get like really close. I'm like, I'm doing it this time. I'm selling a bunch of stuff. I'm gonna make it happen. Then it spikes again. And I'm like, at this point, I can't justify spending $3,000 on a Magic card.
No, that's
I just can't do it.
That's fair. I mean,
The only way I'd do that is if like I would sell off my like a pretty large sizable chunk of my collection. But again, I like being able to be like, ooh, that deck looks janky. Let me run through all my random crap and put it together. So
yeah, I mean, you could almost start a Chick-fil-A with that, with $3,000. That's pretty, I mean, like, I would rather, you know, save up another $2,000 to start a Chick-fil-A franchise and you know, work my way to a playset of Tabernacles.
Plus you'd always have Sunday off.
Yeah. Yeah, that's definitely good. Work 6 days a week.
Exactly. Yes, working 6 days a week sounds awesome.
But you also have Sneak and Show listed, is that right?
Well, yeah. Well, what I was going to say is, yeah, I think Maverick's going to be up there, and you're going to probably see Maverick in some top eights. But I don't think it's necessarily going to be because it's that good. I think it's because of the numerically, there's going to be so many decks there. I think they're going to start sneaking into the top eights.
I agree.
Sneak and Show is the one I think is going to be one of the biggest winners of out of this.
Mm-hmm.
Which Sneak and Show has notoriously been one of the OGs of Legacy, and it's never been a bad deck. It's always been one of the top decks, but it took a step back with the Grixis Delver builds and the four color controls, and then the Leovolds and all those variations. I mean, the slight variations of the same deck. I think now that Deathrite's gone, Sneak and Show is completely back, and I think it's going to be one of the big boys. If I had to make a guess right now, what's going to win the Pro Tour? That would be my guess.
Yeah, and you know, you're right. Like, I think these kind of true combo decks, like Sneak and Show and Reanimator, kind of, and again, Reanimator is kind of one of those things where it was like Reanimator was hurt, you know, game two, mm-hmm. against both of these cards, really, against Grixis against Deathrite Shaman and Probe. But, you know, I guess more true combo decks benefit from these cards being gone. And mm-hmm. and so we're definitely going to see those decks kind of spike up, I think. And that's just my prediction, is we're going to see some of those decks. And I think you're really right about Maverick just being kind of a more budget-friendly version of a Legacy deck. Like, you know, you could do green white, you could do green white blue, you could do green white black. Like, there's different variations on it,
and there's Punishing Maverick, so you can play Plateaus, which I know they've dropped back down in price. I mean, there's you're not gonna get them for like $40 anymore.
No.
And then, like, so you, but it's like you play like the three cheapest duels. It's like you can play like Plateau and Savannah and what's it? So green, red, and Taiga. And then just play one of each and get your fetches, and then you have the deck you can play.
Yeah,
I mean, it's not necessarily optimized, but it's you're pretty dang close, and it's you can show up and sleeve it up and compete.
So before we get out of here, we're gonna discuss cards that maybe could have or should have been banned. I mean, the hot button one is Stormforge Mystic that kind of shot up to about $70. I don't think either of us really believe that Stoneforge Mystic is too powerful for Modern, is it?
No. Stoneforge is fine. Oh, I'm sorry. Stoneblade is another deck in Legacy.
In Legacy, yeah.
That will probably see a big jump.
Yep.
And sorry, I know we're trying to talk about something else. The one that I want to caution everybody on is everybody thinks that Miracles is going to jump up to being the premier deck again. I think it's going to stay right where it is. I don't think this banning does anything to make the deck better or worse. But anyway, Stoneforge and Modern, completely fine. Stoneforge will be unbanned. He will be slightly, or she will be slightly played. My guess is that they're going to do the exact same with their Wizards is going to do the exact same thing that they did for Jace, is they're going to have Stoneforge in a master set or a conspiracy set or some sort of supplemental product that they want to sell, and then they're going to unban Banner. And this is not an original idea of mine, by the way. This is a heard the guys from Brainstorm Brewery talk about it, and I completely agree.
And they're going to probably reprint it with the GP promo art, which I think is the better art.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's one of the, like you said, it's a marketing thing, and I think they will definitely wait until after the next Modern Pro Tour, just so that they don't disrupt testing or anything like that. But
Wizards is not as dumb as we think they are. There's a lot of cards. The reason they don't print them for a long time is they want their secondary price to go up really, really high. So when they do finally reprint it, we all go out there like Tasmanian devils and crack packs trying to find one, and they make money.
Yeah.
I mean, Doubling Season could have been printed in a dang core set or a standard legal set and been fine. The reason why they waited is they wanted to find a set that he wanted to sell, and it was the lottery card.
Yeah. And, I mean, you also have Ban Ancient Stirrings in Modern, which is surprising coming from a Tron player.
So the reason I mentioned this was this has been the Burn the Witch card that's been going on for a while. I know a lot of people have been talking about banning Ancient Stirrings for, it feels like it's been going on for like 2 years.
It's been
every
a while.
Every time the ban cycle comes up, this has been talked about. I think Wizards is ultimately going to do it because at the end of the day, they do listen to their community, and there's just so much hate for this card right now. I think it's ultimately going to go. And I think Wizards really does believe that it's fine. The fact that it is green, not blue, sorcery speed, and only hits colorless cards. I think Wizards feels that is a fair way to do it, but I mean, in Tron and in the Ironworks decks, I mean, it can be bonkers.
Yeah, and our arch nemesis, which is Lantern Control.
Yes.
And you also have one last thing real quick. You have Unbanned Earthcraft in Legacy, which is very spicy.
Why is it even banned in Legacy? Like, I think it's kind of like when Black Vice was banned in Legacy. It stayed on the ban list for forever. And then they finally unbanned it, and it did absolutely nothing. And I think Earthcraft is going to be the exact same way.
Bitter Blossom.
yeah, Bitter Blossom. Again, Earthcraft, I guess we should probably even read what that does, because it's such an obscure card.
I actually sold you an Earthcraft.
You sold me your copy. Yep.
Yep.
So it's one green and one. Tap an untapped creature you control. Untap target basic land.
So notorious combo card with Squirrel's Nest. Yeah.
So again, will people try to play it? Sure, but I don't think it's gonna do anything bonkers to the format. I think it'd be 100% fine.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm sure like we've said, we have our opinions on what maybe should have or should have been unbanned. But I think these bannings are okay. Restrict shops and vintage. We both agree about that. Even though I've never played vintage in my life, I think if a deck is being oppressive, you know, do something about it. Gosh darn it.
If you can play four copies of a Power 9 card and no one else can.
Yeah, that might be a problem.
Or a Power 11.
You're going to have a bad time.
Yeah, you're going to have a bad time. You should have pizzaed when you French fried.
So again, remember you can reach out and talk to us about these and any topics on Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook as FishcastMTG. I'm not Cody Smith on Twitter. And Matt, where can we find you on Twitter?
I'm at Matthew Caudillo on Twitter.
And if you have a longer form question or want to discuss anything in particular with us, you can reach to us as fishcastmtg@gmail.com. Our cover art was made by Tessa and Hunter Pruitt. And if you like what we're doing here, please rate and subscribe to us in the Apple or Google Play podcast app, as well as find us on Patreon at patreon.com/fishcastmtg. You could also go to the Spreaker website that we have on I post it on Twitter every week, and you can get our RSS code feed and put it into whatever podcatcher device you have. Thank you very much for taking the time to listen to us rant about reserveless cards, and we will see you reserveless cards, banned and restricted cards. That's it. And we will see you all next week.
Have a good night, everyone.